Oklahoma, and I tried to see tornado, and that was my dream. But this dream never came true here in Oklahoma. And then during this JAWS project in Denver, Colorado, I saw my first tornado. Not in Oklahoma, not in Chicago, it's Denver. And I know that Denver, at a certain point, became the almost second capital of tornado because everybody tried to chase tornado because the Enka is there. Therefore, to a certain extent, if people are very attentive to a storm, you probably increase the number of tornadoes. And Dr. Dosan, France, told us that we have no tornado in Spain. Well, we know that rain in Spain, but not tornado in Spain, because they really don't care about tornado, I think. How about Japan? They're having a tornado, and they got the one of the, not one of the, probably the worst tornado near Tokyo at the city of Mubara. Therefore, from now on, Japan might be reporting more tornadoes. Now we had a good presentation of tornado in Shanghai area. That means that tornado will become rather interesting international firework. Today, my talk will be Plainfield tornado, which I worked with Bob Maddox, and he came over to Chicago to see what kind of tornado it was. And it was a very interesting tornado, and I probably better show you a number of slides which I brought here, if it's ready. Can you hear me down there? Well, probably it's better if you could dim your light a little bit, or not entirely. Can I stand over there? Yeah, I'm a small man, you know, therefore I may not be covering the large part of the screen. Well, at my school is right over here, the University of Chicago, and this is the tornado in the Chicago area. What you see, the two-colored tornado. Tornado never will have a different color, but it's a red color, the before the 1979 tornado, about 100 years, whatever we could get. Black one is after 1980. And as you see that, this is the Plainfield tornado, Plainfield right here. I commuted from the University of Chicago to around here for Nimrod project, for Danvers project, and I drove here quite often, day and night. Sometimes I came back 1 a.m. Therefore, I know this place very well. However, I never thought that this can be hit by F5 tornado, but it happened August 28th. And the Chicago Tribune newspaper called me. Maybe I thought it's a joke. I said, see, you can watch a tornado here. I said, well, I live here. And they said, don't you buy a house here? I said, well, it's inconvenient for commuting. Then I said, no, I don't want to buy that. And the newspaper reported that, see, Fujita said, tornado expert said, he will never buy a house here, then this is not the place to live. Boy, it was a pretty bad, actually, alternation of my intention. Therefore, I thought that, well, whenever you talk to a newspaper, you better be very careful because your real intention or idea may be distorted. But we are getting a lot of tornadoes here, no doubt about that. Of course, tornado will never tell you where it will be occurring next 10 years. It happened to be here. And then I thought, well, we got August 28 tornado. That may be probably the last one for a while. And then March 27 this year, 1991, only one week ago, we got a tornado starting from here. And it moved right over Ramont, which was hit by a 4 tornado, 1976, and it ended over here, leaving behind the 16-mile-long track. But this, fortunately, was F3, according to Dwayne Stigler, who flew over from here to here. He took pictures again. Because I like a quick response, because we have to fly before cleanup takes place. Especially in the suburb of this kind of big city, cleanup is very fast. Next slide, please. Now, as usual, satellite should be analyzed in some way. In fact, what you see, the Lake Michigan, and you have lots of checkerboard type of lines. This is the 10 minutes, not a degree. 1 degree is from here to here. I divide into 6. And then I counted the temperature below minus 50 degrees. And the isoline of gold temperature is every degree of centigrade. And here it started. And this is where microburst started. And downburst, microburst area is over here. It turned into tornado at this point and ended right over here. Therefore, I kept this downburst tornado area at the same place here and here. And then let the cloud move right over the area every 30 minutes. Here, starting 1:30 p.m. at the local time, and at 2 p.m., 2:30, and next 3. Next slide, please. We'll show you the change. As usual, cloud become bigger and bigger and bigger. But what we should realize is that cloud area is so large. From here to here is quite large. However, radar echo is very small. Well, it's usual, because when thunderstorm develops, cloud will be shooting up into stratosphere, producing ambu cloud. Ambu can extend quite a bit, large area here. Now, later on at 4 p.m., we have a bunch of echoes, but during the tornado time here, this is about tornado time, we have a 4 tornado at the time over playing field area right here. But as you see, echo is so small. Now, let's try to take a look at the next figure, which is, next slide. This one is the same gauze. However, I selected, this is 2:48 p.m., about 45 minutes before the tornado. But this is shortly before the downburst start touching down here. And this whole area is the ambu, colder than minus 50 degrees. But it's a gauze. Fortunately, NOAA 11, which is a polar orbit, satellite was passing here. It's a northbound, equator is over here, and it was going north. And then it scanned the same area, like that. And the viewing angle, nadir angle, as I computed, was only 28 degrees. Then NOAA 11 satellite was looking down much more in the vertical direction. It's very good. However, the geostationary satellite over the equator was looking at this cloud in a nadir angle of 48 degrees. Therefore, view is fairly slant. Then whatever satellite measures in terms of equivalent blackbody temperature is the integration of a slant range penetration into ambu. And it cannot penetrate deep into the ambu because you are looking in slant direction. Whereas, next slide showed this is the same 1 degree counter of a cloud top temperature by NOAA 11 here with a 1 kilometer resolution. This one, by virtue of the viewing angle of 28 degrees, it's very close to nadir looking, you can penetrate lots more because your optical depth is much larger. As you see here, temperature in this area is much warmer. That means that sensor is looking deep into the ambu, probably so. Interesting thing is right here, where you have echoes. But radar echoes show that two peaks, not a peaks, but two high intensity cores. However, satellite, NOAA satellite, also see the two peaks. Well, I may say twin peaks because it's a television. we can see much better than I like to call the twin peaks. NOAA satellite see twin peaks. I'm delighted to see that. And then I enlarge this area, square area, using the 1 degree centigrade counter line. And you might want to see that in next slide. Yeah, this area, small area, see here. Surprisingly, twin peaks. I like that. This, I call it west peak, it's the east peak. East peak is lower than west peak. I can say the lower, but temperature is warmer. And then we have all junk around here. But very interesting feature is that two peaks I can identify. These two are overshooting tops, probably, at that time. And then when you analyze this every degree here, in fact, this temperature is minus 67.6 degrees here, minus 61.5 degrees. Our satellite is so good that you can pick up overshooting tops. And then all around it, we have a high temperature ring. What is that? This is the first time I ever pay attention to it, but it's warm all around it. Is this the case of tornado or downburst, or this may apply to all thunderstorms? I don't know, because it's the first time I ever seen it. Fortunately, we have a United Airline radar. That is the 5 centimeter C1 radar, but they happen to use the RHI mode, and they got this one here. These two, actually, echoes represent probably these two peaks, because this location, that location, exactly come to these two points. Therefore, I have a dual observation, one from a polar orbiting satellite and one from United Airlines vertical cut. It said the top is about 65,000. Time is 254, it's very close. This is a little bit later. Let's take a look at the enlargement. Next. Here. See, we have, this is the west peak. It's the east peak. This is a little bit later, but I'm putting it backward because I have to scan from United Airlines near O'Hare Airport toward the west. Now, what I'm seeing here is the cloud top, not the echo top, from satellite cloud top, and this one. And this one's sinking here quite a bit because this high reflectivity core is almost on the ground. This should be producing outflow, whatever it is. But this one may be just a little bit too early. Now, next slide will show you enlargement of this. It's a west peak and east peak. But radar, as far as I know, didn't see high temperature ring. I don't know what it is. Next slide. Now, when I put these two peaks, and this is a west peak and east peak, but I identify this a young peak and an old peak. This is me, this is you. Because I know this is old because the echo is sinking already to the ground. But it's very interesting when Duane Stigler's direction determination from Cessna indicates that this is very close to the point of initial downburst impact point here. And this one is an old peak. It reflectivity actually counter hits the ground already. High reflectivity echo hits the ground already. And this is the onset of this particular microburst. And then young peak. This is still too young to hit the ground, but radar on it hit the ground. However, this is the one which probably produced the playing field tornado. But at this point, I can never tell if this one did or not. But anyway, this is the estimated location of the center of this particular peak or activity center at the 250, and here, it's a 3 p.m., and a 3:05, so-so, and this is a playing field tornado. My best estimate of the center of the circulation, in fact, video taken from the Sugar Grove showed the world crowd here. World crowd here. I will show you that. And we have a tornado number one. Initially, I call this microvortex. However, it is almost certain that this microvortex came out of this world crowd. Storm chase in Oklahoma would definitely call this tornado, small tornado. This is tornado number one. And tornado number two. In fact, this video showed the tail end of this tornado at the funnel aloft. And then tornado three, tornado four formed, and finally major playing field tornado touchdown here on the river near Oswego. Now, if we just extrapolate this or interpret whatever, this is the center of the world cloud mesocyclone, which actually moved here, and then tornado touched down as usual on the right side of the mesocyclone. But mesocyclone diameter is about three miles. It's quite a big one over here. And then mesocyclone center moved down here, and then tornado touched down. But it's very interesting. When I think before hitting brain field, it reached F5 intensity. At that time, tornado mesocyclone center was almost directly over the F5 tornado. It was almost a vertical system. And after that, mesocyclone center drifted away toward the east, and the tornado actually disappeared over here. Now, let's take a look at the next figure. This is the clear indication of the downburst, or microburst, you call it. See here, we always look for slanted roof, because Duane Stigler has quite a sense, and I shouldn't say he's my follower, but he's going ahead of me. I have to follow him. And he tried to look at these things and saw the slanted roof. Sure enough, see, wind came from above. Usually, when wind comes horizontally, you see the rather weak wind, because this acts as a wind break. But when slanted roof and when air comes down from above, you suddenly see this. Of course, you have some damage here. But this wind came from above in slant direction. This definitely was a microburst, series of. Next slide. Now, this is a mesocyclone, I think it is. And this is the world cloud. And this was moving pretty fast. And time was 2:04. And 49 seconds later, I should say about 2:05. At 1 minute later, center moved this far. This is the Aurora Airport, and this is a video location. And video actually, he took a lot of pictures, but in all directions in a way, covering even this funnel aloft. Now, let's take a look at the mosaic of the video to see world cloud. I think it's a world cloud, but if you don't think it's a world cloud, let's examine that. Next slide. Don't see the world cloud? It certainly was there. And I saw this kind of thing in the Fargo tornado analysis way back in 1957. This is the world cloud. This is a tail cloud. This is a tail cloud. It's a 1 minute radar, 47 second radar, 1 minute radar. See, it's 180 degrees due south, and it moved almost 15 degrees. It's moving pretty fast. Now, from this, we can estimate the diameter to be about 3 miles. Therefore, we definitely had a very interesting hook. I shouldn't say hook, but a world cloud. And now I'm almost certain that we had a rotating thunderstorm over here. But this time, no tornado. We expected tornado, but we got not major tornado, but small tornado. We had two of them, or even three of them already. Therefore, I think we should call this a small tornado descending from the rotating thunderstorm as evidenced by the video pictures. In order to produce this, I sent Duane out. He's a very good, savvy guy. And he went there, and we have a panoramic camera, and he shot panoramic shot like this. And we pieced them together in the framework of the panoramic shot. Then we saw this, to a big surprise. Hey, we got a world cloud long before the plain field tornado. This should have been reported, but this was not produced by the meteorologist, but I think it's Paul at the College of DuPage. And he probably was so interested, but he never reported that, I guess. Next slide. Now, this is the radar echo at that time, almost the same time. And if you, with your imagination, you might say some hook or something, but by looking at this picture first, you never dream of a hook echo or a world cloud here. But when you see world cloud first, hey, you might have something. Therefore, it's entirely dependent upon which one you look first. I saw video first, and I could imagine something here. Then, next slide. Yeah, this is the, you call it tornado. I called it microvortex first. But now I have to call this tornado because this came down from that world's cloud circulation. And I will enlarge this. This is the Duhem's picture. Next slide. See, I don't call it a straight line wind. We have a definite cyclonic circulation here. And then comparing with my other damage estimate, in order to blow down this cone, this is a pretty healthy cone in Illinois. Yeah, you really need a F2 wind. Now, I'm not using just a building to determine wind. You know, even if my estimate is 50% off, we can still imagine that this was F2 tornado. In fact, the end found the farm outbuilding standing way out here. It was damaged and roof was gone. Therefore, if we get this kind of thing, that should be classified as a tornado. Now, I joked about it this afternoon. I went through so fast. I'm sorry about it, but I wanted to show you lots of pictures. That was the whole intention. Next one. Now, at the time, this is 12 minutes after 3. That means that 8 minutes after that hook, water cloud circulation, you definitely see. But you know, bad thing is that here we have range markers superimposed right on there. Then depending upon your imagination, you see where you put echo, hook echo, or center of circulation, it may be around here. Next slide. And this is the touchdown point, Oswego. I change the direction, this is north now. And you see this, this is every 2 minutes. This is 41 degree, 42, 40 degree, 40 minutes, and this is 38. Therefore, I have every 2 minutes of longitude and latitude. And this is the Fox River, Oswego. And what I expected is that since hook echo seemed to be over here, then you should see a regular touchdown and a continuous damage extending from here. But I could see in the end picture nothing but like a F1 wind. Interesting enough, we have a local here, wind effect. This appears to be like an eye. This is like a swirl, this is a comma. And here, if I estimate based on the cone, this is the wind was very strong here only, and next one here. It's not periodic, but spontaneous. And then after that, I start seeing the suction vortex, single, twin marks over here. And then here is the Wheatland Plains, where quite houses are damaged. At that point, I think it probably reached about F3. And then this is the F distribution along the path, but I put the estimated time over here. This is 60 minutes after, 17 minutes after 3. Now, let's enlarge this area to see. Next slide. Maybe you can see here. This enlargement, comma, appear to be like that. Swirl appear to be like that, and I. And here, even some of this cone was evacuated quite a bit, then this could be F3, right here. And here, I. Now, here, lots of silos are blown, actually, from this point, this point. In fact, you see three of them. At the C, blown off, and it came here. But A went up and made a loop and came here. That's quite a bit of activities over there. Then next slide, I'll show you how I would look like. Next slide. Beautiful eye. You call it tornado. This is a vortex right beneath the world cloud or hook echo circulation. What you call this? I'll call this eye. You may classify it as tornado. But you see, what we have to watch is that I talked about this with Greg and see that we can create a tornadoes depending upon how you define it. But if you define tornado as being the little bit smaller scale circulation beneath the mesocyclone, if it's your definition of tornado, this is a tornado. I probably can find 10 eyes. Next one. And then after that, this is F5 area, and I have to show quite a change variation over here because you got lots of suction vortices, one after another. I'll show that picture to you. Now it got into playing field. I think it's weak. I think 3 or 4. But, you know, like I have have no time to do engineering estimate, or no engineer went out here to estimate the wind speed. But in any case, it's a variation very large. But interestingly enough, that some buildings are completely taken away, and some even mobile home are staying nearby. That means that wind speed varies quite a bit. And we have a major difference between engineering estimate and the meteorological estimate. Engineers try to think that the winds are uniform. It's easy to handle it. If a wind changes around, you know, within small volume, they can compute it. Therefore, engineers like to assume uniform wind, but structures are all different. But the meteorologists don't like that. Meteorologists want to see wind changes, but structures are all the same. It's easy. But in that respect, both are wrong. We are wrong, engineers are wrong, because wind can never be uniform. And also, structure can never be uniform. Both are wrong. I don't know how you shake hand on that. But anyway, this is, and I will show you these things here. And certainly, all we agree is that when you buy house built after, what, 1973? Be careful. Next slide. This is a short trip before tornado ended. It's a tragic ending. That the tornado shows some mark before hitting here. Tornado actually came over here. This is a three-story apartment. It's a three-story, two-story, I think three. Three-story. But as you see, tornado center moved over here. You see? But this is just an apartment complex wide. Yeah. And then you could reduce your height all the way down. Well, this we have a separation here, almost to the ground here. Then this is, you know, this clearly tells you, don't stay on the top of the floor. Yeah. If you stay on the roof, it's worse. But in any case, then when you get a tornado warning, where do you go? I have no place to go. I prepare to die. What happened here is that lots of people are actually thrown out into the cornfield over here. But you see, corn, I'm a short man, and I can hide in here. In fact, some burglars can get into a cornfield and stay there for days without being caught. It is that bad, actually. And what happened here is that they try to find the bodies because they try to make a head count. And they don't care about this debris, but they couldn't make a head count fit. Therefore, what they did is do haircut here. Next slide. Then took this next day, and then this is the day after that. And see, they cut a cornfield like this, looking for bodies. It's not too comfortable to think about this. But can we really warn this? Even if you can, if you are sure that tornado will be hitting this apartment, how can you send a warning out? But this time, tornado was weakening. It looks like F3, but tornado really core is only 10 meters wide here. It's a very narrow tornado. Therefore, tornado can be small, but it can be intense. And the tornado diameter and the intensity may not be correlated precisely. Next slide. Let's come here. I agree that I'm sure this was built after 1973. No argument about that. Yeah. But you see, this is a garage, and here you can find the how this is anchored. This is worse than just a mobile home. See, you have a clear foundation. You know, but why this house was blown off here and that this was blown down, leaving the probably, you know, you may find a bathroom or a toilet seat or something down here. I think it's pretty, you know, what is this damage? It's pretty hard to estimate. Well, you can estimate F scale, but you can have a F2 mobile home or F1 mobile home and F1 doghouse. Even F0 doghouse over there, then you can't estimate it. But in any case, why then this house? We can't say that this house were affected by the same wind. Now you see the car over here. Maybe some car went in the lake. Therefore, actually, all meteors can say that, see, this is the worst wind here, relatively speaking. And here, it just completely went down here. Therefore, even if you have a mobile home here can stay. Next slide. Now, this is the vertical shot, and this is the wind estimate. Lots of trees over here are blown this way. That's the first wind. And in fact, what happened here is that, okay, this enlargement, first wind came and second wind here. But interesting enough, this may be F3 could be 4. But what I'm talking about is the minimum wind, not the maximum wind. Minimum wind produces damage. Now I will show you the cone. All around it is something like that. This is a pretty good cone field here. It's a cone, it's taller than I am. In this cone field, I saw surprising things. I need your explanation because I can't explain. Next slide. I thought, see, if a wind is like F0, it's okay, because I saw cone field in many tornadoes, and after F1 tornado, like F2 tornado, cone will become flat. And this is a super flat, F3. But F4, you start seeing the ground. F5, everything's gone. But I haven't done, you know, wind tunnel experiment, but at least I can tell you the graduation, how quickly it changes from 0 to 5. That's quite a change. Next slide. Such a healthy cone, how much wind do you need? I'm not an engineer. I can't estimate the wind, but this is worse than F2. That's what I think. And we took a few days radar. Next slide. See, this is the center of a tornado. And the first thing Duane told me after he came back is that I never seen a tornado like that. Usually, this tornado is moving at 40, 50 miles per hour. Therefore, always on the right side of the tornado, depending upon which direction you see, you have to have a strong wind on the right side, and the center may not be that bad, and the left, you may even don't see bad damage, because tornado is not symmetric with respect to the center line. But this one was, and this is a center line here. Center line, we have a debris deposit. This is no more than 20 meters. Debris deposit, that's a deposit at the center of suction vortex. It's only 1 meter wide. But here, 10 meter wide. That means the tornado core was 10 meters. But everything is just lined up like this. But what you have to be very careful is that you take a look at that. This is a final wind, second or last wind. First wind is this way. Look at this. Here, first wind. Therefore, at this location, tornado wind changed 90 degrees within a matter of probably 10 seconds. I don't believe that you can compute the effect of tornado wind. Hurricane wind, okay, but tornado wind, assuming one unidirectional wind speed and direction, it changes. I will show you more evidence of that. It changes so quickly. But what you are seeing is the final wind. And you may have a damage caused by this one. But last wind could be stronger than that. Therefore, what we are estimating quite often is the minimum wind speed, which could produce the damage. That's a fact. But you never know what second wind was. Final wind, in this case, are very strong. Next slide. Now, this is what surprised me and Duane. Look at this. And tornado moved like this here. Yeah, from here to about, then it's 1 mile, is it half mile? Yeah, half mile. Yeah, then from here to here, 200 meters, this is 400 meters. No, this is 400 meters, and this is 800 meters, half mile. In terms of meters, it's 800 meters. And you see this one here, it's a trailer, was blown from here to here, 500 meters. That's quite a flight. But in that flight, I found 5 bounce marks. And initially, I thought that this high wind, but it was not. This was the, there was no dent or no bounce mark, but this is the truck of a car. I will show you that later. But interesting thing here is that, see, this is the tornado core. And the damage is symmetric with respect to this. This means the tornado wind speed should be much, much larger than translation speed over, say, like a 50 mile per hour. And I have lots of reason to believe that we got an F5 wind here, which I can't prove, but there are lots of reason to make an educated guess. Next slide. And here, this is a car, came out of the Highway 30, US Highway 30. Car actually got in here, and this is a pickup truck. Nothing was lost here. This means that it's pretty good. Next one. This one not that lucky. This one actually tumbled over here. I see a couple of bounce marks here. It ended up like this. This is like a regular tornado damage. You have nothing to surprise. Next slide. But this one will give you a little bit of surprise here. I talked about this car, and this car first, second, third, fourth, and it tumbled, pickup truck, completely destroyed. And this is a trailer, and actually tractor and the trailer were separated at this point. And the tractor ran it over here, and the trailer, after first, second, third, fourth bounce, rested over here. And this is a tornado core, probably, because we have a debris deposit. And the core shrunk very small from here to here, and the core became very large. But surprisingly, what you see here is that south end, or may not south end, this end, a right side end here, I see a series of evacuated cone. What is that? Because it's not a car truck. Car cannot travel like this with tornado. And then this is the very interesting area to study. But anyway, from here to here, first, this car, this automobile, it says car. I don't know what kind of car, and if I know that, probably everybody will buy that kind of car because it stands in tornado wind. And it actually, first it was drawn into a tornado and then went around the tornado center, I think, and it came out of here. But this car was not damaged. I could see front seat, back seat, but no roof. I could have taken this free ride here, you know. I really want to do that someday. Because who can take a free ride going around the F5 tornado and come here? Next slide. See, this is the, what if I say, straight line of words here. Here, it's only 20, actually, meter wide, or 10 meter wide tornado core. Core is becoming big here. It's widening. And on the right side here, look at this. I don't know what it is, but I don't think this was done by solid object. Let's take a look at the enlargement. You see core diameter here. And then it became very wide here. Let's enlarge this section here. You can see every single cone. Next slide. Here, see? And here, my estimate is F-scale wind will probably F3 the most, because you can definitely see the difference. But here, probably this could be F5, and it could be F4. It's a core. And the wind, we talk about meteorological wind shear. Boy, nobody can stand this, because this, from here to here, within very short distance, you probably had the 100 mile per hour difference within 10 meters or 5 meters. That is, you see tornado, like a vertical wall, it's spinning like this, and if a tornado spins like this, it's a weak one. But with a very straight wall of funnel, that's probably what it is. And after that, this one became big, okay? Take a look at next slide. That will show you here. See, core, this end of the core is here. That other end is over here, became large. And you see eye here, right at the center. This is the first time I've ever seen the center of a circulation, and this is the tornado circulation. On top of it, your mesocyclone. These three came straight down. This is a very rare case. I never seen anything like that. Of course, after the tornado, when you interview local people, I never seen anything like that. But I'm telling you, I haven't seen anything like this. After serving quite a number of tornadoes, then actually, that's my statement. See, center of circulation, bigger circulation, the tornado this big. And then we have a mesocyclone on top of it. I like it. That's why I can proudly say that my hobby and my occupation coincide. I like, this is my hobby. Next slide. Now, see, this is I. Here, next. Here, before tornado core shrunk into this, this is the, you know, not well-defined, but suction vortex over here. You see that here? Several here. This tornado core was very large. Next slide. And we can go further down here this way, see? What are they? If you don't call the suction vortex, call every one of these tornado, we can make a 10,000 tornado a year in the United States. Even I can produce 100 tornadoes in France, Dr. Dusson. This is very interesting. Therefore, that's why, you know, I can't forget it, and this is my hobby. Really? I like tornado, but tornado may not like me. Next slide. Next slide. See, this is the sightseeing car. This car started from highway, sorry, and then interestingly enough, when you see this, you see cone was bent in the direction of car motion. This means that this car, you know, this car over here, it not damaged this car, okay? Interestingly enough, car was moving right above the ground. Maybe 1 foot above the ground, but it did not even leave a tire track. You have to have vertical motion to do that. And then here, you see, it did. I think here, and it go around here. I'm almost certain that because I could see no car and here. And the fact that you see here is that car was moving right, you know, maybe 1 or 2 feet above the already blown down cone. Next slide. And this is a car. This is an engine. You see two tires, and this is a front seat, back seat. No human being in it. But what we know, what that, you know, Bob Malk confirmed also, 4 people died in this field, but probably not in this car. Free sightseeing around the tornado. Next slide. And this is the car track over here, because rescue people later on drove here. They found out it's pretty hard to drive here. They drove right on the car track here. This was done later. Then I went here, took a picture of that. Next slide. Like that. Car plus highway. But you see, this actually, these things were done by automobile, but automobile it didn't roll on the ground. What can make the car to float 1 foot above the ground and travel around tornado center? You see here, tornado core center over here. Next slide. I can see this one here. Yeah. Next. And this is a trailer. This flew at least half a mile. Maybe not half a mile, but I have exact dimension. Next. Then I tried to find where it came from. See, this is a resting position. Yeah, it's a big one. Dwayne and I went up there. Boy, it's a big one. I couldn't even move it. Next slide. And this is a trailer part of it. But this trailer actually landed here after tornado moved out here, because you see debris deposited by that tornado actually was disturbed afterward. Then you can reconstruct the, you know, chain of event. And this is the tire from the trailer. And I know exactly where trailer started. Next one. The aerial photography is very good. And the aerial photography, photogrammetry, I should say. See, this trailer truck was driving here toward the north. And all of a sudden, strong wind started coming from the left. Then he did not want to be blown off the highway. Then he actually crossed the center line here. There's no oncoming car, fortunately. And then trailer actually tilted and hit here. This is where trailer mark is. And this is where tractor trailer. And then trailer was separated from here, and then tractor moved a little bit, and then it emptied all of this cargo. Next one. This is exactly what happened, I think. It just hit here, tilted, and then it's a debris depot, and this is the first bounce mark. And this one went here, and then plowed into the debris already created. And you might say, why after tornado, wind can be like this? This is not a wind direction. This is a trajectory of tractor. Tractor was probably running at high speed here. Therefore, it has an initial momentum in this direction. Therefore, wind actually changed the direction. Therefore, this is not a wind direction. Wind direction could be like this. But tornado is moving. Therefore, this is a moving impact and moving tilt. And then trailer actually hit here, and it produced an impact hole. I went out there. Next slide. Here, you see that? And this is a cargo, merchandise right here. This is a stamped steel, I think. Next, and I could find the 4 or 5 marks over there. Now here, plywood. It's a 3/4-inch plywood. Now, this is just stuck into the ground. It's pretty hard soil. You can dig it in your finger. Next one. When you see from the side, don't you think it's pretty good? Plywood? That's why I want to call it a 5 tornado, incredible tornado. Next slide. This is a beam. Beam is pretty strong. Beam field, you can see damage. Soybean is pretty strong somehow because it's a very short. But under a 4 wind, next slide, estimated a 4 wind, next one. Boy, it's pretty hard to do this. Wind is on the ground, literally. Next slide. Okay. This is the right north side of the truck center. Do you think that the wind direction is constant? See, this is the initial wind came this way. This is from southwest. And tornado approached, this is just north of the center. Therefore, wind direction changed from south, gradually this became east. You see, 90 degree change. And not only that, the successive wind came later, which produced the corn crops sitting on top of the earlier one. Then you can see the change of event. This is a convergence, you may call it. If it occurs simultaneously, you may call it convergence of vorticity. But this occurred within a few seconds. If a house is over here, what happens? You think house will rotate or stand there? I don't know. If you don't like convergence, I will show you within 20 meters, I can show you divergence. Next one. Don't you think it's divergence? See? This wind is an inflow wind, and then this is a final wind. Wind changes, all right. This is a tornado. I'm not talking about a hurricane. I'm not talking about the missile cyclone wind. That's why I'm saying that if an engineer assumes that tornado wind is uniform, they're wrong. At the same time, we are wrong if we say all buildings are constructed the same way. If you keep your car and open your garage, the chance of losing your garage and whole house is very great. Everything changes in tornado. Next slide. Now this is the echo. See here. Oh, I'll finish next 10 minutes quick. Here, I pick up the echo at the time of a satellite picture because fortunately we got the satellite picture, rapid scan every 5 minutes. And we worked at NESDIS and I worked, and Ralph Anderson, my counterpart researcher, did this. We did all kinds of things. And then this is the best possible for me, echo, and then damage superimposed. And here, this is the time when world cloud was photographed. And this is the best hook I saw. However, hook became very weak because this is the HP, high precipitation. And finally, the center of the circulation was right in the middle of the echo. Then tornado actually was gone. That's my interpretation. Now this is the satellite. This is a radar echo at the time of satellite. And this is the satellite picture start time is 2001. But it starts scanning from the top. Therefore, by the time scan line came right over playing field, it was 2.7 second later. This is scan time. Therefore, I have to use the radar time 2.004. Otherwise, I make a 3-minute difference error. I did that. Therefore, this corresponds to exact satellite scan time. Next slide will be satellite. Now, this is very interesting. I tried to see how cloud top will change. In the early days, I mean not until last year, I was so interested in cloud top temperature. But cloud top temperature may mean not too much, unless we pick up the twin peaks or something. But here, you definitely see the change in cloud top, amber top. Let's pay attention to this one here. Don't you see animal fingers? It's the only time I could see that. I call this amber top finger, amber top finger. And the finger changes. I can't determine quantitatively how finger is finger, but I can make another scale, finger scale, which I made, finger scale. Because finger scale, this is the best. And actually, top of the finger, temperature about 2 degrees centigrade colder than the environment. I know what's causing it, but it takes time to explain that. Next slide. Then finger scale here. 5 or more distinct elevated fingers, okay? Wait until we get the better satellite. Next, God's eye will give us a 4 kilometer IR resolution. And later on, you see that we should design a new satellite. 3 or more well-defined fingers or so, no finger, whatever. Then I checked every one of these satellites at the time of the scan, and this is how amber top finger index changes, see here. The worst finger, or highest finger index was when F5 was here. And this is the four small tornado time, and then here, finger, and this one corresponds one-to-one. This may apply to this plain field tornado case only. I can tell you that, because it's the only one I did. And this is the most spectacular tornado anyway. However, I would like to compare this to others. Have a twin peaks. And Ralph Anderson and I are now working to go back all data to see if we can match the polar orbiter and geostationary satellite data together. We will have some development within the next few months. That's all I can predict. I can't predict if this can be generalized or not, but this is a one step forward, the use of rapid scan satellite picture, taking picture from 22,300 miles above the equator, looking 48 degrees down here in northern Illinois. Next slide. Let's compare that. I put a valley here. Definitely you see the difference. This is the picture start time, 2026, 2031. And this is where tornado was. Of course, tornado location is as viewed from equator different. Next slide. And temperature is interesting. This is the temperature. And here, this is where tornado was before F5 stage, just 5 minutes before that. Not the best finger. And next one, the best finger stage. Next one. See, whole cloud top temperature warmed up and finger formed. And this is the cloud sub point, and the cloud is shifted 15 kilometers this much because we are looking at a 48 degrees. Therefore, you have to make this correction, otherwise you can never tell where is the zenith point of a tornado. That's exactly here. Therefore, I think now we can do lots of things. Initially, I thought this is a gravity wave. It's not that simple. It's easy to say gravity wave, but it is not. When it's created, it's formed in finger form. Is this the last one? Yeah, next one. Okay, now I will tell you time and effort. If you're not employed free, aerial photography, you can do it in one day. Dwayne can do it half a day. But if he brings back half a day flight data, you have to catalog photographs, do photogrammetry, and damage mapping. It takes 5 days. Interpretation of airflow, where car went, and what is the scale change? Then you have to do radar echo analysis. I won't skip this because I know a lot about Doppler radar because I did the three experiments, Nimrod, JAWS, and the MIST. I know it, but I know it takes time. Not many people can interpret single Doppler radar. Thanks to Bob Serafin, giving me a good chance to learn Doppler radar out of the layman. But now I think I'm layman plus on Doppler radar. It will take this question, you may fill it in 10 days, 5 days, or whatever. But satellite data analysis, Ralph Anderson, I put it 20 days. It will take more than that. Then people think that the aerial survey is very simple. No, sorry. Aerial photography is very simple. You can take picture, but I wouldn't analyze just any picture unless this is given by Greg Forbes or someone, because you really need a controlled photography. Well, now, I want to spend the next few minutes. Next one. You might be interested in seeing that. How many tornadoes we had in the United States? 30,000 tornadoes from 1916 to 1989. This was divided by F scale may not be accurate, but this includes 30,000 tornadoes. See, we have a Missouri trough over here, and this one. Interesting thing is that eastern 20% of Kentucky have no tornado because Appalachian Mountain is acting as a tornado shadow, you know, rain shadow. And I can stop Oklahoma tornado very easily because in China, they don't have much of a tornado activity because South China Mountain extends all the way to Tibet. I would suggest that if you don't want a tornado here in Oklahoma, produce a great wall of United States extending Appalachian all the way to El Paso. You got it. Then, since this is done by computer, I can do it computer. If I plot, you know, I'm old man, then we have to computerize it. We can plot the whole map about 5 seconds now, not 5 days. Now, I quickly made, before I came here, you know, every 10 years, you might want to see that. Every 10 years, tornado distribution, okay? Next one, using our tornado tape. 1980s, 1980 to 89. Enka. Yeah. you can hide me where you are establishing a new meteorological center. I can tell immediately by running my computer. 1980s. How about 1970s? Hey, Enka was there, but probably they didn't organize the storm chaser, probably. Now I want to see NSSL, 1960s. Oh, this is the anniversary of Jumbo outbreak of tornado, and I changed this map, not completely, but I used the downburst area in the open here, because I had to do it, because when your mind changes, your analysis changes. What I want to do is I want to go back. I have every single data which I collected during the past, since 1957. I have all data in my office. I want to reanalyze it to get something new, because when your idea changes, your analysis changes. But this is a reanalysis of jump tornado outbreak. Next slide. Then this is the 1960s. Jim McDonald, are you from Texas Tech in Lubbock? In that respect, University of Chicago is nothing. Next slide, 1950s. I started working here, late 1955 on or something around here. But Missouri Hall is still here. 1940s. Yeah. It's interesting. 30s. Twenties. I don't have a tenth because before 1916, Oklahoma was not in State of Union, I think. It even changed the tornado statistics. Well, sorry for taking a long time, but I thought you might be interested in how this old man did during the past 30 years here in the United States. And I certainly appreciate honoring me, or may not be honoring, but you may have a you may want to criticize me, that's all right. But in any case, I try to do my best using all I can possibly do. But all I'm proud of is that I never get air sick. Thank you very much.